Yes.
Welcome everybody to the last Thesis show. And again, I have to thank my committee, Rachel Lockowitz, Carmine Yonkoni, who's not here, David D'Amico, all the faculty, David Pagel, and Ray. I'm sure there's other folks in here, but they've really been helpful in kind of guiding me through my process here the past 2 years of making art. I also want to thank Jennifer and Rosie, our program manager and secretary, because they really, really, really keep all of us together. I also want to say a special thank you to Roman Reese, who's sitting in the back. Building from the time it was dirt on the ground to being built. So he's a fantastic artist, a fantastic teacher, and so thank you, Roland. I'm a mixed media artist, and so you see a lot of different types of artwork in here. And the work that's in the gallery tonight is really kind of boring. It comes out of historical context, and so the pieces that begin over here to my right is an ongoing body of work. And it's really there one, two, three, four, or five or so pieces that I consider one piece. I call it Index Obscura. And what that is about is really bringing to the forefront African American artists in history, making some of their contributions known. And not just the superstar artists, but just artists in general. And I think it's something that all artists can relate to. This came to me partly in the process of looking at art history books and learning more about different periods of time in art history and kind of wanting to see more of myself in that and wondering, where are Black folk? What are they doing? And so I took it upon myself to start doing some research. And one of my muse for doing that was Dr. Simone Lewis, who was an artist and historian, and was a professor at Scripps and other places, and she began a journal called Journal of the International Review of African American Art. She started a museum in Los Angeles, and has really just been a champion in art history. So I was reading an article in the journal that she started several decades ago, and he was talking about a man named James Porter, who was like the father of African-American art history. I didn't know anything about that. So at one point, I came to this idea of the Index Obscura because I found this old box. And I work with found objects, and so it reminded me of the old index cards that we use in the library. So I took it upon myself for this project to start trying to name all the African-American artists and women artists that I could think of. I just started writing them down. And I continued with that process and then started looking at some reference material to find out more artists. So that's really what's represented here are a number of artists. They're in no particular hierarchical order. And they range from people who are very famous to those who are very obscure, which is kind of the really what happens to a lot of artists. We make our work, we're not superstars, but we're making work, we're showing wherever we show, and we're doing what we do because we can't help but not do that. So that's kind of what this is about. These pieces here in particular, these sculptural pieces are part of it, and the images that are on here are actually some reproductions of work by a few people that are on the table. Ultimately, I want to expand this so that we have more visual art to go along with the names. The other thing about this is that this piece incorporates this paper, which is a process that I documented here in these photographs. When I first got here, I came here with all these ideas, the great things that I was going to do, painting and so forth. And I reached a point one day, I was like, well, I can't, you know, what do I have? I had tracing paper in the studio, so I started playing around with the tracing paper. And ultimately, it led to a wall painting, collage of paper, this process of paper, and it pushed me to take a lot of risks doing work that I've never done before, just trying new things. I spent a lot of time trying new things. But that's kind of the beauty of being here, is that it's a place where you can go take those kinds of risks, try new things, new ideas, and see where it takes you. The other thing about that is, this kind of relates to the idea of documenting as well. This is an art, you know, it served as an archive of some work that I did. It's not really represented in the room right now, but it was very important to me my first year here. And so I would have felt remiss if I didn't include it somehow, in addition to using it on these wire sculptures. Some of the other things that you see here are these circular spiral forms. Those are really inspired by African graphic symbols and writing systems. I also have been exploring that. And so I kind of took to one. There's an adinkra symbol, which looks like a target. And the meaning of that symbol generally means greatness, you know, or the greatness of God, or just greatness in general. And so I wanted to take that to push myself to try to be as great as I could be while I was here, doing what I was doing. So it reoccurs throughout different pieces in my work. The painting. This, I've never worked this large before in my life. I was working like 24 by 36. I was comfortable. I graduated up to 48 by 60. I thought I was doing big things. And is this me going here?
No.
So he gifted me these stretchers, actually, to work on. So I bought canvas and, you know, 9 by 10 foot painting. It was kind of intimidating in the beginning. Okay, what are you going to do? And part of my inspiration was an artist named Norman Lewis, who did beautiful, beautiful abstract paintings. And then the other part of my inspiration for it was a collage piece that I had done, which involved a lot of windows. And when artists were inspirational to me, it's a very small piece, but I keep it because it means a lot to me. And so I started working. And this is what emerged, and I'm still getting used to it. It's almost for me like, I was once on a day, felt a little bit like birthing an alien baby. Because I felt like it's like, okay, that came out of me. I'm not quite sure what it is. I guess it's part of it, you know. So I'm getting used to it. It's true, because I mean, that really is how I felt. And I think sometimes, some parts, we do things and we have ideas, and then the art does what it wants to do. It dictates to you what's going to happen. And so it dictated to me what's going to happen. And as I look at it now, I think of it as a meeting place, really, for all these artists and more artists yet to be discovered as I continue my research, a meeting place for them to come together and survive and thrive as artists, you know, past, present, and future. The other thing about my work is that it's very tactile. I just, you know, I'm very tactile in terms of texture, working with different materials, and just making things with my hands. I'm a maker. It's a pile of trash. I'll figure out a way to make something out of it. And so, textiles have played an important role in my work in the past. And so, the piece, very simple, quiet piece that I love, is actually fabric that I did batik with, and collage onto the canvas. I've had other pieces here that are very kind of textile in their patterning, the repetition, and also in the symbols that a lot to African symbols where graphic symbols were a way of communication. So, you know, there were alphabets, syllabaries, icons and things. And so sometimes one symbol can mean a very complex concept. And so rather than, by speaking or, speaking actually, I don't want to say speaking because there's a lot of oral truth, but graphic symbols held a lot of meaning. So people would look at something and communicate certain concepts and viewpoints about life and wisdoms and all of that. So I incorporate some of that in my work as well. The other thing I can say about the work is some people probably say, oh, that's a lot of yellow. and it is. I will say that prior to working here, I did have a broader palette. But I've always had yellow in my palette because it's very luminous. I use it a little more judiciously. But it's a very luminous color. It, for me, it kind of evokes a new day, sunlight, translucence, and luminosity. And so it's just a very, it's obviously an important color.
How do you get the idea of the painting?
Sometimes it has to do with history, personal history, where I want to do. There's really not, and that's another thing, there's not a lot of figurative work here before I do big more figures, people work. Oh, thank you. But different things. Sometimes it's color. Sometimes it's the material itself. Just something that I see and I want to make something out of it. Sometimes it's an idea. So it's the world around me. It's my environment. Those things are inspirations. And currently, yes, sometimes things happen to people or places in life, and you want to express your ideas or feelings about that and make it come out of the car. Yes, young man. But I'll tell you why. Because it's an important color to me because of the light and the luminosity, and I feel like it shows that there's something behind that's yet to be discovered and yet to be seen. You don't see it, but kind of as a glow, like in the sun is down there.
Please tell me if you continue big. Are you going to continue with big kids?
I would like to continue working. It's very physical. Yeah. And you can get into a big pain in a way that's different from working smaller scale. I mean, you really kind of get your body into a big body and soul. It is difficult if you don't have space, particularly if you're working on a stretch canvas. So initially, we stretched this and the stretcher bars will actually collapse and put it through a wall. I mean, through a door. I think you'll find that a lot of artists work large, especially, even more so starting to just, not stretch the work. You work on the wall, you shove on the wall, and stretch when you stretch it, maybe the condition is going to size it and buy it and take one. So you want to stretch it. But I would like to work things. This is just my beginning. Pretty much everything in here, I've done a lot of discovery here. So it's been good in that respect. I don't love everything, but I've learned a lot here, and I've cared about that.
You had mentioned that some of the pieces in the levitating objects for people on the table are. Is this like representations of it, or are there pictures? Like I see there's pictures.
These are their actual artworks. For example, this is a piece called Cleaning Fish by an artist named Lois Jones. This, and I love these also because they're sort of interactive in general. This is a piece called Banjo Lesson by an artist named Henry Oswald Tanner. This is a piece, I forget the name of it, it has to do with the city, either Philadelphia or Pittsburgh, but it's a collage by Romare Reardon, who was an excellent collage artist. And this is another piece that I actually love. It's a bronze sculpture. It's called Malcolm X III. It's by Annalise, by an artist, woman artist, named Barbara Chase Bradbaugh. And she did a series of bronze sculptures. And this was what was exciting to me in doing some of this stuff. I never knew about this woman. And I've never seen her work. It's gorgeous. I mean, part of that is on me. You know, but that's part of why I'm doing this. When you take it upon yourself to find out more about things you want to know about. And for me, I like to share that. And I would like to teach you that.
Simplicity is so elegant. You have a very complex intellectual and this beautiful that you're considering in this here in front of the canvas, and you have simplicity kind of do that. Does that reward you to do something when you stop at the right moment? You know,
actually, yes, I have never thought of stopping. Another very wise man, Paul Reese, told me when I was telling him to do this big thing, he's like, you know, keep it simple. So this, you know, you start out, keep it simple. So my idea was to keep it simple. But it complicated itself. The piece that you're referring to right here is actually based on a section of this one. So I was able to extract some of the simplicity out of it, and do that piece. I do like really kind of minimal pieces, and what I'm finding another thing with my work is that work that I admire that other people do, where I think, I want to do that, I don't want to work like that, and then I look at what happens when I'm like, that's pretty much now, I just roll with it, you know, I'm still kind of tight, but I'm a lot freer with my work, and I take more risks, and I just let it happen, and go ahead and show it, you know, sometimes you just have to let it be.
So I'm interested in knowing how, at the process of you looking at the wire and working with it, does it symbolic to you, or do you, because you work with a lot of material, do you say, oh, this is look good, or is it, you know, it's all magical?
I'll tell you the story of how this works. I'm also very interested in artists' books, in making handmade books. And I had this brilliant idea that I was going to use wire to make a book, more conceptual than an actual codex when you really turn the pages, but I started wrapping these so that you could kind of go in between them and kind of make pages. So to me, in a sense, this is a book. But that's how the pieces got started. And then they're so flexible that you can kind of take them, you know, you set it down and it started to kind of smush into a different shape and all like that. I kind of like that. So then I became more purposeful about just using something to, you have to have something to create the form on, but then, so I still have the same process of trying to create something that's kind of like, you know, something that can serve as a page, a structure, be it accordion or just wrapping around. Even some of these things, to me, they're like pages, kind of connected at one point. So that's where that came from. It's a lot more sculpture. It's kind of, you know, getting into a sculptural realm. But I really would like to continue with this and pretty much do an installation that's focused on this work with this subject matter.